today.
Hello, dear students. Myself, Jalaja Sajeev, PGT Bio from KV BSF Camp Chavala, welcomes you all to the live session. It is rather a distant mode of education, an online platform, a great venture initiated by KVS RO Delhi region. A big salute to all the members of the team and the team captain. All of you join the session very soon. After a long gap of schooling, now you are back to the classroom. And we can enjoy the learning of biology. You all know that learning of biology at this time is the need of the hour. Each and everyone should learn biology to serve yourself, to save the society, to save the nation. Now, in this session, I am going to teach you the chapter 1, that is reproduction in organisms. In this chapter, we will cover some of the aspects like life span in different organisms, the different types of reproduction and its importance, then the differences between sexual and asexual reproduction, and the various events that takes place in sexual reproduction. So before going to this, it is better to know about the basic aspects, the basic knowledge of reproduction. What itself, what is the meaning of the word reproduction? Yes, you all know that reproduction, can divide the word into two, reproduction, production of young ones of same kind by an organism. One particular organism produces its own copy. So it is called as a reproduction. And all the progenies, all the offsprings, they will be similar to the parents in almost all the aspects. And why the process of reproduction is needed? Suppose if there is no production of any of the species, then the entire population or the entire population of that particular species will be finishing. It will be vanishing from the biosphere. So for the continuity of a particular species, reproduction is essential. And it will result in variation of characters. It will result in evolution. And with only reproduction, we can maintain the biodiversity. Now here in this chapter, the first concept, that is lifespan. Life span. Now, what is lifespan? That is the duration between birth and the natural death. The period or the duration between life from between the birth till the natural death. That duration, that is called as a lifespan. Now, in your textbook, NCERT textbook, as far as biology is concerned, that is your Bible. You have to go through each and every line mentioned in the book. Then only you can score very good marks in your board examination. So give emphasis to the biology content, NCERT textbook, the line, each and every page. So here in your textbook, there mentioned the lifespan of different types of organisms. So in your board exam, this is a very important question. Definitely in every year there will be from this aspect. Here there are certain organisms. One is elephant. Elephant is its life cycle, its lifespan is 65 years. You can see it in the PPT. I am showing it here. In elephant, the lifespan is 65 years. Then in the case of a rose plant, it will live for 10 years. It is an amazing fact. We never know, but it can live for up to 10 years. Now coming to dog, 20 to 30 years it lives. Coming to a butterfly, the lifespan is very, very less, 1 to 2 weeks only. Now, a crow can live for 15 years. You know, banana tree that lives for 25 years. Cow can live for, again, 25 years. Here you can correlate. You may be thinking how these concepts can be easily learned. You have it to correlate some aspects. You have it to correlate things. Then only you can learn. Here I will give you one important aspect. How to correlate and how to learn this lifespan of different organisms. You know, cow is a herbivore and it can eat banana. So cow and banana here is correlated and both are having the same lifespan, 25 years. I think it is clear. You can easily memorize the concept. Now, parrot is so beautiful, small one, but it lives for 140 years. 140 years is the lifespan of a parrot. Again, we can correlate here crocodile and horse. Crocodile and horse both are having the lifespan 60 years. So that you can correlate. Easy to memorize. Two organisms, horse and crocodile, both are having the same lifespan, 60 years. Now coming to a fruit fly. What is fruit fly? You know, it is Drosophila melanogaster, commonly used for cytological as well as genetical studies very widely in almost all the labs. So that itself is yet another question for your examination, short question. Which organism is widely used for genetical as well as cytological studies? So the answer is Drosophila melanogaster, or its common name is fruit fly. So why it is known as fruit fly? It is known as fruit fly because it is commonly visible in fruits with a red eye. So its life cycle is its life span is 1 month. Now for a rice plant, The lifespan is 4 months. For tortoise, 100 to 150 years it can live. And for banyan tree, 200 years it lives. So you can learn this lifespan aspects, a little bit of correlation as well as memorization. When you are reading and listening and repeatedly reading, things will be in your memory. Nothing to worry. Now coming to the next aspect, that is reproduction. Already I have told you, reproduction is the production of young ones of same kind by an organism. And the importance of reproduction is, yes, of course, continuation of a species generation after generation. And by reproduction, there occurs variation of characters. And mainly by sexual reproduction, there occurs variation of character and it will lead to evolution. Now, what are the different types of reproduction? We can divide it into two categories. One is asexual reproduction and the other is sexual reproduction. You have learned the same concepts in your 9th class also. Even in 8th also you have learned these aspects. Asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. Now, what is the difference between these two reproduction? What is meant by asexual reproduction? Asexual. A means absent. What is absent? Sex organs are absent. No need for any sex organ. So reproduction with or without the involvement of a gamete, that is called as asexual reproduction. And sexual reproduction means there is the need of sex organs and different types of gametes. So reproduction with the involvement of gametes, that is called as sexual reproduction. Now, you have it to discriminate or you have it to identify or distinguish the differences between sexual reproduction and asexual reproduction. It is very easy. Make two columns. You can see here in the presentation. First one is asexual reproduction and the other one sexual reproduction. There, in asexual reproduction, it is uniparental. What is meant by uniparental? One parent alone is needed. So it is called as uniparental. But in sexual reproduction, there is the need for two parents. So it is biparental. Two separate parents, male parent and female parent, both are needed. So it is called as a biparental. Then asexual. So that means there is no sex organ. But in the case of sexual reproduction, they are present well-developed sex organs. When there is no sex organs, no formation of gamete. So in asexual reproduction, there is no formation of gamete. But since sex organs are present in the sexual reproduction, there is the formation of gametes, male and female gametes. In asexual reproduction, there is no fusion of gametes. When gametes are not there, there is no chance of fusion. So fusion of gamete is commonly known as, yes, fertilization, or at another name is syngamy. So in asexual reproduction, there is no syngamy or no fertilization. But in sexual reproduction, fertilization or syngamy is present. No zygote formation in the case of asexual reproduction. But zygote is formed after sexual reproduction. You know zygote. What is the ploidy of a zygote? What is ploidy? Level of a chromosomes or number of a set of a chromosomes present in an individual. That is known as ploidy. Zygote contains two set of chromosomes. So it is diploid. You know how many cells are there in zygote? Yes, it is unicellular. So a unicellular diploid structure formed after fertilization, that is called as zygote. So such type of a zygote formation is not there in the asexual reproduction. But in sexual reproduction, zygote formation is there. Then no embryo formation. If there is no zygote, then there won't be any embryo formation also. But in sexual reproduction, there is the formation of embryo. Now, what is an embryo? From zygote, embryo is formed and the process is known as embryogenesis. We will see all these aspects in the later part of this chapter. Progenies in the case of asexual reproduction. All the progenies, they are similar to the parents in their characters. But in sexual reproduction, the progenies are differing from their parents in most of these characters. That means no variation of a character is present in the case of asexual reproduction. And variation of character is present in the case of sexual reproduction. When there is no variation of a character, there won't be any chance of evolution. So, in asexual reproduction, there is no chance of evolution. But in sexual reproduction, there is the chance of evolution. So, once again, I am briefing this difference. Now, I will say the first column, asexual reproduction, all the points once again. Listen carefully. Asexual reproduction, uniparental, only one parent is involved. No need for gametes, no involvement of sex organs, no fertilization, no zygote formation, no embryo formation, and all the progenies are identical to their parents, no variation, and hence there is no chance of evolution. I think if one aspect is clear, the aspects or the points of asexual reproduction is clear, then you can write the points of sexual reproduction. Now, anyway, coming to these sexual reproduction points, see the columns. It is biparental. Two parents are involved here for this reproduction. Sex organs are needed. Gametes are formed. Then there is fertilization or syngamy. After that, there is formation of a zygote. Then there is formation of embryo. And progenies are differing from their parents. That means there is variation of character, which will lead to evolution. Now, what are the different asexual methods of reproduction seen in different organisms? Here you can see the different methods of asexual reproduction. So, before going to this aspect, already I have told you all the progenies are similar to their parents in the case of asexual reproduction. So, the progenies formed in asexual reproduction, they are morphologically as well as genetically similar to their parents. Hence, they are known as clones. A very important question for your examination. It can be asked like this. For example, suppose you are producing 50 plants from sugarcane cuttings. What term will you give for these progenies and why it is so? So what term we will give? That is clone. Why they are called as clones? The answer is they are morphologically and genetically similar to their parents in all respects. So it is a clone. Very important question for your board exam. Now the different methods of asexual reproduction. There the first one, that is binary fission. This binary fission, bi means two. Fission means division. So binary fission means one particular organism divides into two. So two daughter cells are formed. One cell divides into two daughter cells. For example, there is amoeba, there is paramecium, there is euglena. So all these organisms, they divide and produce two daughter cells. And these daughter cells are identical. So this method, that is called as binary fission. Now it is also yet another important question for your examination, 2 mark or 3 mark. Either diagrams will be there in your question and you have to label it and identify the method of reproduction. Otherwise, definition, what is binary fission, and draw a labeled diagram of the same in amoeba. So it is yet another important question. Very easy. You know the structure of an amoeba cell. Nucleus, vacuoles, cytoplasm, and there is pseudopodia, the endoplasma membrane. So first it is a nucleus that enlarges in size. Then this nucleus will elongate. Then small groove in growth developed from the plasma membrane. You can see here in this diagram in the computer here. Small cytoplasmic ingrowth. Plasma membrane will grows inside and this will deepens. And here the nucleus then divides into two and forms two separate nucleus. Later the cytoplasmic grooves will deepens and unite together, dividing the cell into two, the single amoeba cell into two. So this simple method of reproduction, that is called as binary fission. Once again listen, the single nucleus enlarges, first step. Second step, it will elongates. Third step, the cytoplasm produce ingrowths on either side at the same point in the middle. Nucleus then divides into two. Then the cytoplasm also divides into two. So two daughter amoeba cells are formed. Second method, that is included in your syllabus, that is budding. You know bud. 9th class also you have learned bud. In 8th also it is there, budding, bud. So what is a bud? A lateral outgrowth or a projection that is formed from the parental body. It is called as bud. Here in the diagram you can see the bud. So at first it is attached with the parental body, then it grows, it enlarges. After its growth, it gets separated from the parental body and it can give rise to a new organism. So this method of reproduction, that is called as budding, and it is shown by yeast and hydra. Now what is yeast? You might have heard about yeast in your 11th class. Yeast is an Ascomycetian fungus. What is Ascomycetian fungus? It possesses ascus. Ascus contains a particular spore. Yes, you know, it is ascospore. So since there is the formation of ascospores inside the ascus, this type of fungus, they are known as ascomycetes. And this is a unicellular fungus. Yeast is yet another unicellular fungus. So it reproduces by bud formation. You know, what is the scientific name of yeast? Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Very important question. It's binomial nomenclature. Scientific name is a one mark question for your exam. Most of the children will write the name. There will be spelling mistakes. Then there won't be any marks. And when you are writing this binomial name or scientific name, you have to follow the principles of binomial nomenclature that you learned already in your 11th class. That means genus name you have to write first, followed by species name. Second concept again I want to emphasize here is the first letter of the genus name, that must be always capital. And species name begins with a small letter. When you are writing the exam, board exam, very fast, you will forget about this aspect. You will write in both the letters or the entire name in small letters, then you will never get any marks. Even though the answer spelling is correct, answer is correct, but mark you will never get because you are not following the principles of binomial nomenclature. So binomial nomenclature is very, very important. And scientific names, when you are writing, you have to follow it very strictly. Then, you know, it is always in italics. It must be written in italics, but it is difficult. So when you are writing handwritten, it must be underlined separately. That is also needed. So Saccharomyces cerevisiae or yeast that reproduces by budding. So two examples here, one is hydra and the other is yeast. Now some additional aspects I want to give you here is, I have already told you this is a binary fission, but there are other methods of fission also. One is multiple fission. What is this? Multiple means many. That means the single nucleus present in a particular organism, for example, amoeba and even plasmodium. You know plasmodium, that is malarial parasite. So these organisms, during unfavorable condition, it is surrounded by a very thick wall. That then it forms a cyst in order to overcome the unfavorable condition. And on the outcome of this outset of this favorable condition, the nucleus divides and produces so many amoeba. So that particular method, that is called a multiple fission, where the nucleus will divide many times, followed by cytoplasmic division. Each nucleus is surrounded by a little bit of cytoplasm, and it forms this daughter amoeba. And same amoeba can reproduce even by sporulation also. That you can see here, sporulation. They will form spores. So nucleus divides. Here also the method is same, but there is no cyst formation. Small spores are formed. Nucleus divides surrounded by cytoplasm and each one forms a particular spore. And they will germinate and produce new organism. So here there is no cyst formation. Now there are certain other methods of reproduction seen in some of the other organisms. For example, the algae. For example, Chlamydomonas, as well as in fungi, the reproductive structures that are zoospores. It is also a very important question, this aspect in your NCERT textbook, from these four diagrams that is given in your NCERT textbook on page number 6, that will be very, very important. 1 mark or 2 mark question is definitely from that content area in every year. So what are the reproductive structures in these organisms? Algae or fungi, it is zoospores. Suppose in the place of algae it is asked, what is the reproductive structure present in Chlamydomonas? Your answer is zoospore. Now draw a neat labeled diagram of a zoospore. That can be asked. Simple concept. Yes, you can see here the structure diagram. It is pear shaped, then biflagellated, motile reproductive structure, and it possesses only one single nucleus. So pear shaped, biflagellated, motile and uninucleated reproductive structure, asexual reproductive structure present in algae or fungi, that is called as zoospore. Then another diagram, that is Penicillium fungus, Penicillium fungus, there the reproductive structure is small spherical structures. You can see here very clearly, small spherical structures are present, and these small spherical structures, they are non-motile and non-flagellated, and they are always produced in chains in a linear fashion. They are produced in chains, you can see here. So such a type of a structure, they are known as conidia. Singular is conidium. Now the third one in this diagram here is the diagram of a sponge. So in sponges, that is, they are coming under phylum Porifera. So in sponges, they present a flask like structure in the body, and inside this flask like structure you can see small aggregation of cells or group of cells, and these group of cells are surrounded by a outer protective coat covering, and this will give rise to new organism, and this structure, that is called as gemmules. And when they get mature, these gemmules, they will come out through the opening, and that opening is known as micropyle. It is a flask like structure, and inside that flask like structure these gemmules are formed, and when these gemmules get mature, they will be coming out through this opening, and that opening is known as micropyle. Now again, there are five other diagrams included in your NCERT textbook on page number 7. That is again a very important question for your board examination. You all are familiar with the potato, Solanum tuberosum. So this potato tuber, it is an underground modified stem. It possesses nodes, internodes, and in the region of these nodes, you can see small buds, and these buds are arising from small depressions, and these depressions, they are known as eyes, E-Y-E-S, eyes karte, or from these eyes, there develops small axillary buds, and these buds, they are known as eye buds. So these eye buds, they will develop into new organism. If you are keeping potato in a moisturized area or in an environment, then it will germinate, and these buds will give rise to sprouts, sproutings you can see there, and it will give rise to new plant. Then the second one, that is in the case of a ginger, you can see a modified underground stem that is known as rhizome. Rhizome is an modified underground stem. It possesses nodes and internodes. Again, there present axillary buds as well as terminal buds also, adventitious roots, scale leaves, and these buds present in this rhizome, they will give rise to new plants. So rhizome is the propagule that produces new plant in the case of ginger. Rhizome is growing horizontally to the soil, or it grows parallel to the soil, and it is thick and condensed. Then coming to agave, and similarly pineapple also, it reproduces by small buds, and those buds, they will give rise to new plant. They are known as bulbil. So here in this diagram you can see the bulbils. So it is seen in agave as well as pineapple. Then you all have seen this plant, bryophyllum. You can see clearly the diagram here, bryophyllum. Its serrated margin of the leaf possesses notches, and these, from these notches of the leaf, there produces small buds, and these buds are adventitious buds because they are developed from the leaves. So it is known as adventitious buds, and these adventitious buds or leaf buds, that will give rise to a new plant. So from a single leaf you can see so many adventitious buds are coming out, and they give root system also, and they can develop into a single plant. Then at another plant, that is Icornia crassipis or water hyacinth as well as Pistia. So in these plants, there present the vegetative propagule that is called as offset. Now what is an offset? From the base of the shoot and at the junction of that root, from the base, there arises a lateral branch. A thick lateral branch is coming out. It grows horizontally, and at intervals, it produces a shoot system and root system. So it possesses the length of the internode is comparatively less. So it is having only one internodal length. So such a modification, that is called as a offset. It is an aerial modification of a stem. So that is called as a offset. And this offset, it produces new plant. So suppose if there is only one water hyacinth plant in a pond or in a water body, within a short span of time, it produces innumerable number of progenies, offsets. So, it causes eutrophication of the water. And this aspect also we will learn in ecology also and in the coming portion of this chapter. Then another concept, that is vegetative propagation. You know, what is meant by vegetative propagation? You know, here comes propagation means production. Vegetative propagation means production of new plants from the vegetative parts. That is, what are the vegetative parts of a plant? Yes, you know, it is root, stem, and leaves. And these parts, they helps in the growth of the vegetative plant body. So they are known as vegetative parts. And the reproductive part of the plant is? Yes, of course, it is flower. So propagation or production of new plants from the vegetative part, that is called as vegetative propagation. So all these aspects that we have covered here is vegetative propagules. That means in potato it is eye buds. In ginger it is rhizome. In agave, in an pineapple it is bulbil. In bryophyllum it is leaf buds. And in water, hyacinth or icornia, crassipes. Or pistia plant, in both these plants it is offset. There are other plants also, that is an additional information here. Runners, for example, oxalis plant. You have learned in your 11th class also. Then sucker is there in the case of mint. What is mint? Pudina. So next aspect coming here is, I have already told you this water hyacinth or Icornia crassipes, E capital and C small. Icornia, genus name, crassipes, species name, and separate underline. So this particular plant, when it is there in a particular water body, it grows very, very fast. It is an unwanted plant. It is a weed. It is an aquatic weed. And it is introduced into our country. And it is an invasive weed. What is meant by invasive weed? It will spread very fast. And a wider area is covered within a very short span of time. So it results in scourge of the water bodies, or it results in deterioration of the water quality also, and it will uses a lot of oxygen, present dissolved oxygen present in the water body. So this particular phenomenon, that is called as eutrophication. So this particular weed, aquatic weed, unwanted plant, it is known as Terror of Bengal. A very important question. Name the plant or the invasive weed that causes scourge of the water bodies, or which is known as Terror of Bengal. Your answer is Icornia crassipes. Common name is water hyacinth. So it drains the aquatic oxygen, it drains the oxygen, dissolved oxygen present in the water body. So the aquatic animals, mainly fishes, they will die due to the lack of oxygen. So why it is introduced into our country? Even though it is a weed, unwanted plant, then why it is introduced into our country? It is introduced into our country because of two aspects. One, it possesses very beautiful flowers, purple colored flower with a yellow spots at the center. Very beautiful clusters of flowers you can see. In the mainly it grows abundantly in the polluted water bodies. You might have seen this plant. So one is due to its beautiful color, and other is due to its shape of the leaf. It possesses a beautiful shape for its leaf also. So with due to these two reasons, it is introduced into our country. One, the beautiful flower, and the other is the shape of the beautiful shape of its leaf. Now coming to sexual reproduction. And before going to that aspect, sexual reproduction, before reaching sexual maturity, a plant has to grow. Plant or animal, whatever it may be, it has to grow and mature. So what are the different phases that present in the life cycle of a particular organism? So one is juvenile phase. Juvenile means young. Juvenile phase, and during this juvenile phase there occurs growth. So this is known as growth phase or vegetative phase. And during this phase, the plant will grow to its maximum and reaches to the stage of maturity. Then second phase, that is called as reproductive phase. So in reproductive phase, the plant or the animal that reaches sexual maturity, that gains sexual maturity. And in the case of animals, it is known as puberty. Sexual maturity phase, that is known as puberty. So the plant or the animal, after reaching the stage of sexual maturity, it is capable of producing its progeny, reproduction. Then after a span of reproductive time, then it reaches to the stage, that stage that is called as senescent stage or senescent phase. Now what is meant by senescence? Aging. You might have learned this aspect in your phytohormone chapter in 11th. Senescence. So senescence means aging. So what will happen after this reproductive phase? The metabolic activities gradually slows down and it reaches to the aging phase. So these are the different stages or even phases present in the life cycle of an organism. Juvenile phase or growth phase or even vegetative phase. Second, reproductive phase, and the third is senescent phase. Now, there are certain plants or certain organisms, they are capable of reproducing only once in the entire life cycle. So such organisms, they are known as monocarpic. Such plants, they are known as monocarpic plants. For example, bamboo plant that will produce flowers, fruits and seeds only once in the entire life cycle, that is after 50 to 100 years. Then what will happen to that reproductive phase? After that 50 to 100 years, after producing flowers, fruits and seeds, this plant will perish. It will die. So such a plant, that is known as monocarpic plants. Carpi refers to fruit. Mono means single. It can produce flowers, fruits and seeds only once in the entire life cycle. So it is at another important question. Then another aspect is, so there is polycarpic plants also. What is polycarpic plants? Poly means many. That means in the entire life cycle, it can produce flowers, fruits and seeds at any time. Throughout the lifetime, it reproduces. it produces flowers, fruits and seeds. So we will call them as polycarpic plants. Then there is another important concept coming here, that is, there is a particular plant that will produce flowers only once in the entire once in 12 years. It produces the flowers once in 12 years. And what is the common name of that particular plant? That is Neelakuranji. Common name is Neelakuranji. And its scientific name is Strobilanthus kundiana. Strobilanthus kundiana. Strobilanthus again, genus name. Kundiana, species name. S capital and K small. Separate underlines. So it is a very important question. Then, in which month it produces flowers? It usually produces flowers in September, October period. And where it is distributed? It is distributed in the Kerala, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu hilly areas. So, during this flowering season, that means once in 12 years, it produces flowers, and these areas, these hilly areas of Kerala, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, that will be bluish in color. That patches, entirely it is beautiful blue color, and it attracts the tourists, so giving economy to the states. So here you can, the question is, name the plant that produces flowers once in 12 years and give its scientific name. Where it is located? And so this is the question. Your answer is, common name is Neelakuranji, scientific name is Strobilanthus kundiana, and in which month it produces flowers? September, October. Where are they distributed? In the hilly areas of Kerala, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. You can make the abbreviation KKT. K for Kerala, K for Karnataka and T for Tamil Nadu. Now, there is another aspect coming here, that is regarding the animal breeding. Some of the animals, they are producing progenies. They will breed and they will produce progenies throughout the lifetime and in all the seasons. So, for example, rabbit, cat, rat, cattle, all they are continuous breeders. Throughout their sexual maturity lifetime, they can breed and produce the progenies. But such organisms, they are known as continuous breeders. Then, next one, that is seasonal breeders. You know, seasonal, that means in a particular season of an year, they are capable of breeding and producing the progenies. So, such organisms, they are known as seasonal breeders. For example, frog, lizard and birds. So, all these are examples of seasonal breeders. They will breed and produce progenies only in a particular period of the year. Then, based on the reproductive cycles, we can divide the organisms into two separate groups, categories. One is estrous cycle and the other is menstrual cycle. Now, what is meant by estrous cycle? So, it is a reproductive cycle, and in this reproductive cycle, there occur cyclic changes in the endometrial layer of the uterus, in the accessory sexual glands, and there is hormonal changes. So after due to all these changes, there occurs reproduction also. So in estrus cycle, it is shown by non-primates like a cat, deer, cow, dog, and tiger, like this. So they will reproduce only in a reproductively active period. And those reproductively active period, it is known as estrus period or heat period. So the sexual urge will be more during this heat period. So such type of organisms, they are non-primates, and they will reproduce only during this estrus period or heat period in a particular year. Such organisms, they are known as estrus, they are showing estrus cycle. Then menstrual cycle. You all know this aspect, menstrual cycle. Here the endometrial layer undergoes thickening, glands become corkscrew shaped, and hormonal changes takes place. Changes takes place in the accessory, secondary sex organs, accessory sex organs, glands. And there is maximum collection of blood in the endometrial layer. And if there is no fertilization, the ovum is coming out along with sloughed endometrial tissues and blood. So this flow of blood, that is called as menstruation. So such type of organisms showing menstrual period, they are having menstrual cycle. For example, all the primates, that means it includes apes, monkeys, gorillas, orangutans, and even human beings. So all will show menstrual cycle. So I think you all gained many aspects in this chapter. Now go through these contents, see the video, go through your textbook, read your textbook, each and every line you read many times. Then try to understand. If you have any doubts, you can comment and you can ask. I will be clearing it on the next session. Thank you. Stay safely at home and be healthy. Pray for the nation. Pray for yourself, your parents, grandparents, and for the society. Give a big salute to our nation. Bharat Mata Ki Jai.